All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome on into yet another Prospect Planner piece, part of the IA Baseball Network's High and Tight show. Again, I am Andrew Brown. Happy to be with you. Happy to be going along. And what is going to be another fun edition here, we're going to be looking retrospectively at the process of recruiting. You know, we again, I think as we continue to go and give that holistic picture of what the process is like beyond the baseball and softball diamonds, what that looks like from the parents' perspective, from other aspects, what you're going through, what you're seeing. And I think we've been blessed to have, we'll bring on Chad Ericson here in just a bit from RDA Financial. We've been blessed to kind of go through a journey with him and his sons and what his son has been going through, and really the ins and outs that he has seen, what's worked, what doesn't work. So that's going to be kind of the bulk of what we talk about here in this episode, this segment. But again, brought to you by RDA Financial. You know, from whatever it may be, one of the things I do always want to stress with RDA Financial is not only do they know the money, but they know the community. I love the fact that when we get the chance to have these conversations, they're so organic with the fact that Chad's in the community. He's seeing that. He is seeing what's going on in the baseball community at large as well. So that's really the really cool thing, and I hope this has brought a different spin, because there are a lot of entities out there that want you to partake in their event, their thing, you know, right? Or do their workouts. But, you know, how does that pursuit continually look from the parent's perspective, right? And I hope that this gives parents out there a good look and a taste of that. But hey, without further ado, let's go ahead and dive right in as we get rolling here with the one and only Chad Ericson of RDA Financial. And Chad, as always, man, appreciate what's going on here. Thanks for taking the time here as we get ready for kind of that spring break mix.
Yeah, absolutely. It's spring is here, man. Robins flying all over the place. Geese are flying back north. It's here. It seems like we only had a couple of weeks of winter this winter. So we'll see. Hopefully we don't get a deluge of rain to put a damper on spring baseball, but we get that rain during the week and not on the weekends when we need to be playing some baseball here.
Yes. Oh, ready, man. So. I can't wait for it here, Chad. We got conference previews. We've got we just did a look at some teams that we're excited to see, potential repeaters, all that kind of stuff. And it just, and then at the end of the day, you go, oh man, we're still a couple months out. Like, ah, you know,
right?
It hits hard. I needed to start now for my sanity as well. But again, appreciate you coming along here. First, before we go any further, we are at that spring break time. Are there spring break plans in your future here, or is it a staycation kind of a time for you?
Yeah, well, it's a staycation. That's for sure. So Sunday we got a doubleheader in Akron, and it's going to be some spring baseball, some Legion baseball up here. And so Lamar's Community's got a team, and Akron Westfield's got a team. I'm running Game Changer on that deal, so I got recruited to do that.
There you go.
My youngest son's playing on the AW team, the Legion team up here. So yep. I'll be at a baseball field on Sunday, and it looks like it's going to be great weather. So really excited about that, and it's going to be fun. So, won't be long. Couple of weeks, I think there's a tournament down in Council Bluffs.
Yep.
So, both my sons will be playing in that tournament, and man, it doesn't get any better than that.
Yeah,
we're going to be going full bore here pretty soon. So, and then in a blink of an eye, we'll all be regular season high school baseball. So.
Can't
really looking forward to it.
Yeah, this needs to happen. But hey, while we wait, we get the chance to talk on really one, the process through which we've talked about, really the epitome of this show, you know, the recruiting, what that looks like beyond the field. And you know, it's been really cool to see through the journey of how parents can look at it, the ins and outs, and some technologies of it. I know that that has been really cool to kind of chronicle not only what the information we've given out, but your journey as well as being a dad through that and going through that. So that, again, that has been pretty special for us to kind of see and how, what have you looked at? You know, I know that, well, when you got the last couple of trips you took and we talked about, those really went over well. And I, you know, getting a lot more people to go, you know what, that I've seen that. And ultimately that really meant a lot, because it's what we're here to do, right? That's kind of that purpose. And so, well, first and foremost here, it's a retrospective look here, Chad. I know as we take a look back from the 10,000 foot level, now you've gone through it all. You've gone through the stages of, hey, what does it look like before you go get serious about getting into what the seriousness looks like, you know, getting yourself up, getting yourself developed. Then when you're developed, what does that look like? Showcases, all of that, you know, and we've done as best of a job as we could to kind of crescendo that up to a point now where we can look back along with how you've done this with your son as well. But let's take a look back at I don't want to say good, bad, the ugly of it, but let's take a look at really the positives. What's been the biggest, first off, give me the biggest thing, the biggest positive when it comes to the process for you. What's been the best good to come out of this, and what's been the best thing that has worked for you and your son en route to making, you know, get a successful push towards getting picked up collegiately somewhere?
Yeah, so I believe for us, the best thing that we did was get in front of the coaches that you want to play for.
Yep.
Go see the programs that you want to play for. Have an idea, develop an idea of which programs would be a good fit. And I know that's difficult to figure out from the outside. You know, just to kind of fill everybody in here. My oldest son, who's a senior, he's going to make his announcement. He's already signed his letter of intent officially, but he's going to make his announcement here in the next few days. So I don't want to steal his thunder, but it's happened, and he just needs to announce that on social media. So really excited and blessed, and I think he's found a good place where he's going to thrive and be happy and really continue to grow as a baseball player and as a student athlete. So really excited and happy and proud, real proud dad. But I think the number one thing that we did right was we got on the road, we went out and went to some programs and saw some coaches, and he performed in front of folks so people could see him firsthand.
Yep.
And that was primarily in a showcase environment. There were some scrimmages that he participated in, like PBR, for instance, and had a couple of scrimmages that he played in. But things really started to happen once we arrived at what level of school he needed to be at,
okay,
what his game plan was, what would be a good fit. And for us, it was the junior college level, with an ultimate goal of playing at a top 4-year program, mm-hmm, at some point. Right. So his journey is not over. He still has work to do. This is great. You know, going into his senior season, he knows where he's going to play. He knows who he's playing for. He knows what the campus looks like. I mean, all of those question marks have been answered at this point. And so that's a relief. I think that it could be pretty stressful on a kid not to have that answer by the time the season starts. Thank you.
Congrats, big congrats on that. Just waiting for the right time with it, and just had to. But again, congrats, big thing. I'll let you go with the rest of it.
Yeah. So, you know, basically, those question marks are answered, and I think that that's a stress reliever, mm-hmm. right? But what I would say to other parents where their son hasn't signed yet, it's okay. I've talked to some very successful ball players around the area who signed very late, even later than my son. You know, sometimes it happens after the season, and that's okay. You know, if your son's goal is to play college baseball, you can still make it happen, and you can still be very successful and get to a very high level of baseball, even if you haven't signed prior to the season. Yep. And I want to make this disclaimer. Everybody's story is going to be different. I mean, we've harped on that throughout this whole thing. Every time we bring somebody on, mm-hmm. Jaden, Cody, those guys coming on, obviously they have different experience of how they made it to where they ended up. Yep. Right. And so everybody's story is going to be different. I can't stress that enough. And nobody has the perfect answer. Nobody has the perfect path. There's just, you know, we're not all Ken Griffey Jr. by the time we're 19, we're playing at the major league level. Okay. That is super, super rare.
Yeah.
Right. But I was talking with a client down in Texas. His son played some college baseball, and so we've had several conversations over his time. His son's a few years older than mine, but we've talked about this whole process. Mm-hmm. And he's like, "Hey, man, very proud of your son. There's only 6% of high school baseball players go on to play in college."
Yeah,
and so that's an achievement in and of itself. And now it's like, okay, how far can we go? How far can this dream or this experiment, if you want to call it that, how far can this take you? And you have a limited window of being able to do this.
Yep.
Right. And so you play baseball until somebody says you can't do it anymore. You know, you hit your limit. And at some point everybody figures that out. Whether it's age that tells you that or your skill level, somebody eventually is going to tell you. So I just wanted to make that disclaimer. You know, what I'm about to say, what we did right, what we did wrong, that doesn't mean that that's the perfect approach, because it's not. I mean, we spent some money that we didn't need to spend in retrospect, but you just do the best that you can with the information that you have. So, you know, hopefully this helps some people. And, you know, with that, you asked the first question you asked, which is, you know, what's the best part? Yeah. The best part is getting to talk to these coaches, especially coaches that you want to play for, and coaches that have given you feedback that they say, "Hey, I like what I see. Let's keep talking." Right. And those, you know, you want to keep those relationships going and those conversations going until you get to your final decision.
Yeah. Right? And there's the decision to do that here, Chad. I know that you've had to weigh, and your son has had to weigh a lot of different things. I wanted to get to, I know that this could kind of go both to the good and bad, or, you know, the goods and the bads of it all, but you mentioned, you know, getting in front of people and getting there. You've talked about before how, you know, getting that conversation is tough to have at sometimes. You know, it's just tough to get. There's a lot of bodies out there, a lot of talent out there. So when it comes to the communication side, can you tell us, one, the, you know, as we kind of dip into the stuff that you didn't like, or the not so good stuff about it a little bit, but can you talk us through a little bit of the communication factor? What was the best way that you communicated with coaches, and what ways do you wish that you would have stopped or never done in the first place?
So I just had the impression that emailing was not very valuable.
Mm-hmm.
Unless the coach was choosing to contact you via that method. Most coaches wanted to text, and you're not going to get that, obviously, unless the coach is interested, right? But we sent out a number of emails to schools, and there, I don't even know if these coaches were reading them. And so if you're coming from, and we were coming from a place where these coaches would have no reason to know my son. They're not here in Iowa. They don't know what's happening. They don't know that we're trying to go to a school outside of the state, spread our wings, so to speak. And so they're not waiting for my son to email them. So, you know, how do you catch their attention when they get all kinds of emails in their inbox?
You know,
coaches say that they look at them, but they look at a lot of emails.
Yeah.
They're not going to respond to every email that comes in. So we kind of had the conclusion that, okay, once we get into the fall, we got to get out and start looking. We got to do these showcases, and we've got to go to a couple of programs. If they have a campus camp, then we should go to that camp.
Okay.
So that we can get in front of those coaches. Since we knew we wanted to go down the junior college route, JUCO route was great.
Yeah.
They ran really good showcases. The coaches were very receptive, and it was, you know, it was primarily junior colleges, which is what we were looking for.
Mm-hmm.
NAIA schools, Division III, NCAA Division III. I would say those were the primary, but I know that there's a couple of Division II schools that were going to those camps as well. And it was Division I junior colleges, Division II junior colleges, and probably some Division IIIs.
Yep.
And so you start learning from the feedback that you're getting from like a showcase like that, or if you go on campus to a junior college, for instance, or any college camp. If you're not getting that coach giving you feedback, then that should send a message to you that, okay, maybe we're at too high of a level here, and we need to think a little bit more of, okay, geographically, where do we want to be, or where do we want to end up? You know, maybe we're not D1 ready right now, but how can we get there? And so you start strategizing at what colleges should we go visit, and you got to look on their websites and see when their camps are. JUCO route has a website where they share. Obviously, they want you to come and spend money. Perfect Game has showcases as well.
So with that, Chad, I wanted to ask you on that too. You've seen it. You've gone through all those, right? You've gone through. You've seen what works, and you even mentioned, hey, American Legion Ball, you know, take a look at there. Of course, when we talked about developmentally, there's kind of the different stages of where you're at. But when you look back at the showcases, I know a lot of families out there are going, man, well, what ones do I go to? You know, I know that PBR and Perfect Game, love those guys, love JUCO Route. You know, and I love, again, love PBR and perfect game, but you go get to it and go, man, is that the right one? Where are your dollars best being spent there? And a lot of what perfect game and PBR do is they highlight well, but, you know, where are you at developmentally? Because I think the last thing you would want is to go, man, I didn't have a great look there comparatively, like you were mentioning, and to the rest of the group. Yeah, I mean, there's every event's going to have really good talent there, so you don't want to get buried underneath the talent if you're not there developmentally. So, as you have gone through, where have you found that's best to put those events? We'll put them events, right? Because there's showcases. There's a lot of different showcases and varieties out there. I think every one of them have their merits, but what's worked? And again, like you said, this is your route. So everybody, we're kind of taking off of what Chad has gone through with his son, what that pursuit has looked like. So what's it, Chad, what's been the best pursuit in terms of, one, when you do certain events, but also what's kind of the best, you know, I guess been the best one for you, or the best route that you've taken in terms of all the events that you can get out there?
Yeah, so I think we did too many PBR events.
Okay.
And I think, you know, early on I said that we're kind of a PBR family because we did. My son was doing a lot of PBR stuff.
Yep.
And I think in retrospect, we would have been better off focusing on PBR's fall event, where they do a scrimmage game along with the showcase. I think that's better because you're getting some performance and competition in there.
Yep.
I think the other thing too, as you're going through a PBR event, you know, maybe you do a PBR event when you're a sophomore and you just see where you stack up. Okay. And if your name's not getting into those top tier of your class or the entire event, then you may want to spend more time and money on development, as opposed to continuing to do those showcases, because you need to shift that money into development and away from showcase.
Okay. Yeah.
That would be one thing that I would say.
So early on,
I think the trouble that we had and what made it difficult for us is that my son was getting into those top five lists. And so it was like, okay, we should go do this because you're making these lists. You know, your pop time is where it needs to be. Your exit velocity, your distance, your average distance, those types of things. So we kept doing them. And I don't know that two times a year is probably too many.
Okay.
And then I think the other thing is too, some coach, you know, I don't know if it's the same coaches going to PBR events every time or the same coaches going to perfect game. We didn't do any perfect game events. We did perfect game tournaments.
Tournaments.
And if I were to critique PBR versus perfect game, I would say perfect game has a better social media draw than PBR.
Okay.
I think PBR has a better platform for like video and metrics.
Yep. Yeah.
I do know for a fact that these coaches, they will ask, are you on perfect game? Are you on PBR? And they'll go out and they'll look. They'll look at your metrics.
Yeah, they will. I think that is important here, Chad, to at least get yourself in that door and have that. And even if it is just a one event, you do that one event, you work for it and you get there, you still have the data there. Because in the end, you still have to be able to produce tangible data that these coaches can see, along with the volume that of, again, it's only one part of the puzzle. Like you have mentioned, it's just one piece. You got to back it up. But I think that nowadays it is nothing but beneficial to have somewhere. I'm not saying perfect game PBR in its entirety, just them, but have some place where you can have data to put along with that. And because it, you know, like you're talking about, a lot of these coaches have a lot of things to look at. And they're trying to find a lot of what works. And in the end, they got to know that at the base level, you can still perform at a level that they need. And I think that is vitally important if you can show that right away, because then you vault yourself up. But again, that's only part of the puzzle. But, you know, you have to look, like you have mentioned plenty of times, Chad, every piece of the puzzle is really critical to hit every step of the way.
Yep. And I think too, when you go to these showcases, you want to make sure that you're doing things as well as possible. So prepare for them.
Yeah. Yeah.
I think in retrospect, we would have done we would have done a few things differently. Okay. And not just we would have prepared differently.
Yep.
I think. And I think that's where, you know, I know PBR just finished their spring all-state showcase.
Mm-hmm.
We did that event for 2 years, I think, and had a good showing. But after the season, I think that it's more beneficial because you're ready to go. Your arm is built up. If you're a pitcher, you're hitting, you're on time if you're a hitter. There's some things to be said about that. Now, you can only do what you can do in regard to the showcases and the timing of these showcases.
Yep.
So, you know, the school that my son is signed with, they saw him in Wichita, Kansas on January 2nd. He did not pitch that day. They didn't know he was a pitcher. They saw him hit. They saw him catch. They saw him throw from the outfield, and that was enough.
Yep.
And they didn't know that he was a pitcher. That's a bonus. I think another thing that I would say is that my son never threw from the outfield in a showcase prior to that showcase in Wichita.
Okay.
So we did all these PBR showcases, and he never threw from the outfield, even though being an outfielder is a secondary position for him. And we probably should have done that because he has high velo from the outfield, and his footwork is good from the outfield.
Yeah. Do you think Chad, that when as you go through these, do you think you strategize when you do certain things, such as when you do outfield, when you do certain positional showcases? Or is that more of a thing, again, from a parent's perspective, is that more of a thing that you think should be put all your cards out on the table right away? I just don't, you know, developmentally where he's at. And I know that your son has always had a good arm and really good mental footwork about him. So, do you think that, because you can compartmentalize, you can choose whether you do outfield, whether you do one thing or the other. There are different facets that you sign up for to do. Is it worth it to skip some early on as you develop through and then showcase it later, or go ahead and get a base reading sort of thing and then go from there with all the cards on the table?
I think part of it is, what do you have access to?
Okay.
I think anybody can go out on a football field and run a 60 and get an accurate time and figure out where you're at.
Mm-hmm.
But not everybody has access to figure out exit velo, or to figure out pitching velocity, or how much break you have on your breaking ball.
Yep.
Right? I think the main thing is, if you're going to pitch, you need to be ramped up and ready to pitch, which my son was not on January 2nd. He was shut down, right?
Yep.
And we went to another junior college in Missouri in November, and he didn't pitch there either.
Mm-hmm.
That was hitting and catching only. He didn't even throw from the outfield. In retrospect, we probably should have. But the coach, that was a one school camp, and the coach was talking with them after the camp was over. So even though he didn't throw from the outfield that day, I chalk it up as a success. If the coach is talking to you, it's a successful trip.
And right? Two, you know, like you mentioned, are you ramped up to the point? Are you there? Because honestly, you got to give it your all at these things, and you don't want to hurt yourself, but you also. Yeah, you know, sometimes you may get one shot, and do you want to show not your best work or not where you're at most elevated in your performance? I think that goes a long way to that. And but again, you just never know who's watching. You know, shout out to Cody Iggy on that one. Right. I loved his thought about, you know, just a simple inning. And I love your point about the showcase, the events, the performance events, I think is what we can call them. And to show how you perform that, how you perform the metrics that everyone else sees at a showcase, how you perform them goes a long way. Because even though those are, you know, you think, okay, we see outfield velocity, we should know, therefore he should be able to do this. When you can physically connect those two dots there, you move up the list, you know, on coaches' lists anyway. So I know it seems simplistic enough, but you have to sometimes connect those dots for coaches. And again, I love to a T what you were talking about there. Very good stuff.
And I know we talked about this before too, but I really feel like we earlier on in the process, we weren't communicating with coaches effectively.
Mm-hmm.
Because we didn't know the process. But my advice to the ball players out there, share your dreams with the coaches that you want to play for.
Yep.
Because they'll know if the dream is realistic, number one, and they'll help you figure that out in a hurry. But number two, it tells them the type of ball player that you want to be. Do you want to be a ball player that just plays college baseball and then says, that's it? You know, mm-hmm. Or do you want to play, or are you the player who wants to continue to move forward in the sport? So if you started a junior college, you want to get to a four-year school. If you're a four-year school, hey, my ultimate goal is to be drafted, right?
Yeah.
The coaches need to know what your dreams are. And I think we weren't projecting that.
Okay.
And I think once we changed message and said, this is what our ultimate goal is, not to just play junior college baseball, but to play at a higher level at a four-year school, specifically Division I.
Yeah.
And that's when things started taking off, because my son was sharing his dream.
Yeah.
And the coaches were like, you're the type of player that we want. We don't want a player just coming in and playing baseball and taking up a roster spot, because that player is not going to, maybe that player is satisfied. Whereas if you want to go to the next level, you're going to come and play for us. We know you want to get to the next level. So we know you're hungry. You're not satisfied.
Yes. I love that. Are you, you should always be the starving artist so to speak. You're never, never satisfied, always hungry for it. And certainly, I think when all is said and done, the hard work will pay off. It really will. A lot of things going on. And one thing too, ladies and gentlemen, too, we'll make the chance, we'll reference back, and maybe we'll get some new stuff in there about technology and stuff to work with here too. Chad, we won't get into that right now as we're kind of wrapping up here, but make sure to go check out previous prospect planner pieces and the chance. And again, we can revisit and all that again, just different technologies and stuff too, all part of it here. But as we wrap things up here, Chad, I think so much of what comes down is just kind of that communication, that strategic planning and how you do it. And everything has to be as tedious as it may sound, you know, in the end, looking back at it, there's so much that you go, man, thankfully, you know, I'm sure you have gone, hey, thankfully we did that. Thankfully we did that. Yep. Even to the things that, oh man, wish we would have tried that, as you've already mentioned here a little bit. But as we wrap things up here, anything else when it comes to this kind, you know, the journey, I guess, you know, again, everyone's, like you said, every journey's different, but there are so many similarities, even if it's just one little similarity here and there that can connect and just get a leg up. And that's kind of, again, what the point of all this is to kind of help you get there and get that leg up. So, again, kind of a lot of things to dive into, but I mean, anything else that we may have not touched up on?
I think like for, you know, I shared the differences and the good things and the of perfect game, PBR, JUCO route. They do a good job with metrics, and they, you know, these are verifiable metrics as well. They allow you to, you know, you can have a video with JUCO route as well. They probably don't have as robust web presence as the other two, but I think it's a good organization. They run a good showcase. They coaches do go there. I think it's cost effective. Yep. It costs a lot less to do a JUCO route event than it does to do perfect game and PBR. And then when you're looking at doing camps at the schools that you might want to attend, a lot of times those camps, it won't just be that school. That school might also invite other schools to come and take a look. Okay. So we went to another one in another showcase in Kansas City, and it was a showcase at a junior college.
Yep.
But there were, I think, like 40 schools there that day. And there was like 150 baseball players there that day.
Yeah.
And that was bigger than any PBR event that we had done previously. So it was something to see. Another good day for my son. We got good feedback from that event.
Yep.
And so happy about that. But those weren't any of the schools that we chose. We had met with our school prior to that event, but we told them we were going there. So my son could perform. And so at any rate, those events that are held at a school are by far the most cost-effective event that you can do in regard to a showcase. Okay.
Yeah.
I'll give Iowa Western as an example. I think their camp is like $75. So you can go and show at Iowa Western for $75. Iowa Western also hosted a JUCO event in this past year. It was in August.
Yep.
That was cost-effective as well. There were a lot of junior colleges and D3 schools and NAIA schools there to take a look, right?
Yep.
So I would say PBR Perfect Game, those are your higher echelon showcases for higher echelon schools, D1 schools. I know for a fact there are junior colleges there. I know for a fact that there are NAIA schools there and D3 schools there too. But I, for whatever reason, we got more feedback from JUCO route events and direct events with the schools that we were going to see than we did from PBR and Perfect Game.
Okay.
I don't know. That could be unique to us.
Okay. Well, and it's one of the things too, is it shows the viability of JUCO, and just, again, it's so the presence of JUCO is huge. The teams, I mean, you get a lot. And we talked to Jalen Martinez on this very segment, and several weeks back, and he had talked about, that's great preparation. So how you view it is very critical, as you mentioned, and everything of that sort. So, there are so many paths out there. Take heed, take where you want, and certainly do your homework, as Chad and his son have done. And again, we're blessed to have had Chad along this route to help us with all of this. And again, whether you have a Cubs hat on or not, I will appreciate the journey here, Chad.
Spring break is spring training is happening, and I'm enjoying it. Yep. I'm happy.
I
get to watch a little bit of Cubs baseball every now and then now.
It's been way too long. And every year it's way too long. We got to get spring training earlier. I wish spring training could last 2 months, 2-3 months, and then we're into the season, but I get it. Don't want to wear out the stars and all that. So, but, Chad, hey, appreciate it, man. This is, I like how we've done this, and it truly hasn't been able to happen without the organic process in which you go through, you have gone through, and will go through, so this is really kind of cool to break that down. And so for everyone out there, please give it a look, and just take little bits of what you will from it. There's a lot out there, and hopefully we've been able to illuminate a little bit of that path for you. So, but with that, Chad, hey.
Yeah, I hope it's helpful. I hope it's helpful. And if people have feedback or questions, put them in the comments. We're on YouTube now, so put the comments down below. Hit the like button. Subscribe.
Do all of that stuff.
I've watched enough YouTubers. I know. We got to get thumbs up going. And even put a thumbs down if you want. I don't care. The algorithm treats them both the same, so I've been told.
Right? Hey, it's still like, eyeballs on
like
there.
Me, you don't like my smile, that's okay. I'm all right with it.
Hey, I don't know. If they don't like your smile, I'm doomed. I'm doomed for sure.
it's been fun. I've enjoyed the conversation. I think... we'll keep going onward and upward from here, and we'll keep sharing stories, and who knows who's going to be on deck to be a guest as we go forward.
Oh yeah.
It's a lot of fun, and I've enjoyed watching what you guys have been putting out here lately, getting all geared up.
Oh yeah.
With all these predictions. I don't know that I believe all of them, especially the 3A stuff, but we'll, we'll find out come July, won't we?
Oh yeah. Yeah. We'll see. And I've learned that, until teams prove the opposite, never count them out. And the great thing is we have there's never too many. We have plenty of schools in this state that provides so much great competition that you can never be fully confident in your predictions.
Right. And baseball in Iowa just keeps getting better every year. And it's because we've got a lot of great coaches. We've got a lot of great parents. The facilities and opportunities continue to grow and get better. And that's what I love about it. That's what I love about it. It's going to be fun to see what this looks like in 10 years from now, 20 years from now. where Iowa baseball is, and it's exciting. It's really exciting.
Yeah, that no doubt. Excitement may not even be a big enough word to describe our thoughts here. And again, anybody out there, like we said, hey, hit the like, subscribe, share your thoughts, experiences, and take away what you will. Again, you'll be able to catch up not just on YouTube, but of course on Rockfin as well, where we have other great content for you to catch up on. And if you get the chance, hey, help support a small business, support what we do in highlighting not just the students and coaches, but parents as well. So appreciate it. But with that, Chad, man, as always, appreciate it. Can't wait for the next time go around. But again, wanted to give that congratulations. And wanted to say congrats on a journey well paved, and can't wait to see what's next for him.
Hey, thanks. We're excited. Should be a lot of fun.
Yes, no doubt. And hey, ladies and gentlemen, make sure to keep along with us. More coming on up later on. Again, this has been our RDA Financial Prospect Planner. Again, brought to you by RDA Financial. Check them out today. Hey, and not only, it's not just the money, but the community at large as well. Great people behind a lot of great brain power. So check them out today, RDA Financial and more. And we'll see you next time. Bye.
See you, Andrew.